The numbers are staggering. Mental health is crippling Canada. Here are the estimated costs, both human and financial. 1 in 5 Canadians suffer from an addiction in any given year. 50% of us will experience a major depressive episode. PTSD affects close to 10% of the population, and 4,000 Canadians will take their own lives this year. Payton Nyquvest, the founder of Numinus, a Vancouver-based company, is working with Dr. Evan Wood to address these pressing issues utilizing the potential of psychedelics in mental health treatment. Nyquvest openly admits he was struggling with depression. He says, "I had to get treatment, lasting treatment. I sought it out internationally and it worked. And it worked so well, he set out to provide the same opportunities for others." Dr. Evan Wood, a leading figure in addiction research and treatment, is the company's chief medical officer. Wood says studies at Johns Hopkins University and other institutions are showing tremendous gains in mental health and addiction outcomes when psychedelics are added. The therapeutic outcomes are significantly better than common treatments, he says. It's cutting edge, but it's an exciting development in treatment. We invited Dr. Evan Wood and Payton Nyquvest of Numinus to join us for a conversation that matters about the positive outcomes psychedelic treatments are offering in therapy.
Conversations That Matter is a partner program of the Center for Dialogue at Simon Fraser University. The production of this program is made possible thanks to the following and viewers like you. Please become a patron at conversationsthatmatter.tv.
Gentlemen, welcome. I'm happy that you're here because I've been watching these developments in moving towards the use of psychedelics to address addictions. And it's a topic that in some ways I've been fascinated with since I was a kid because I'm a product of the 60s and Timothy Leary was doing his experiments not only with LSD but psilocybin at Harvard University, and then that went sideways and all research seemed to come to an end. And then a couple of years ago I started hearing and reading articles about the fact that no, these very psychedelics are now being tested again, especially in their treatment for addictions. How did we get to this point where all of a sudden now we're able to start to look at psychedelics as being an appropriate treatment?
The field is exploding right now and kind of on the shoulders of decades of work. As you described, there was this, you know, huge therapeutic interest that kind of spilled out of the laboratory into the counterculture in the 1970s, which did, as you say, lead to a real beating back of this research. But at a couple of US and European institutions, a flicker of light remained and scientific groups were able to continue research with these compounds. And that's just opened up tremendously over the last decade with a number of institutions, probably led for the most part by Johns Hopkins, but a number of US institutions and other organizations that have been funding clinical trials with tremendous outcomes that are showing gains for both mental health and addiction-related outcomes that are, you know, in the stratosphere in comparison to some of the things that are, you know, commonly employed in the healthcare system now. So it's cutting edge, and it's a pretty exciting area to be in right now, for sure.
We're not talking about it theoretically at the moment. Now we're talking about it in reality. What was it that gave you the opportunity to be able to go through the process of bringing this treatment to British Columbia with the blessing of Health Canada?
Yeah, you know, we'd been looking at this for a couple of years now, and as you said, just with the growing body of research that's continued to be backed by major institutions, you know, Health Canada's, you know, taking a look at this as well, and through a lot of work with Health Canada, especially in regards to licensing, with some of the dealers license that we do have, to be able to broaden out our research capabilities to continue to sort of move this category along, and so far they've been very, very proactive and supportive of what we've been doing.
Okay, so you have the ability to research, but in your perspective around your company, Numinus, you also talk about having wellness centers. So are you in a position now where you can start to offer this kind of treatment?
Not in a for-profit or outside of a research context way, but the hope is that, you know, with working with research organizations, we can start to provide some of that infrastructure so that when research does convert into practice, we'll be able to house those therapies. And in the meantime, you know, there's still a lot of work that needs to be done on the research side, and being able to help and do some of the heavy lifting there to work with some of those groups is a big focus of ours.
So Evan, on the research side, because this is the expertise that you bring to this and your understanding of addictions and the way that, you know, our brains respond to those substances that they become addicted to, what are the, number one, the different psychedelic agents or components that you might be dealing with? And then how do you go about the process of providing the sort of research that will lead to this ability to offer this to the public?
Yeah, so there's some very different molecules, actually, and along with the sort of cultural baggage, we tend to, you know, lump illegal drugs together, and then even in the sort of psychedelic category, there's some big distinctions in terms of the effects. But probably the big two, the first of those is MDMA, or what is the component in the street drug ecstasy, which actually was used legally in the U.S. There was about 500,000 psychotherapy sessions offered by psychologists and physicians around the U.S. before it was made illegal. And now through a U.S. organization called MAPS, a number of trials have been completed, 6 phase 2 trials, and now phase 3 trials are underway with that substance. They've been quite focused on post-traumatic stress disorder. Mm-hmm. And in the U.S. context, that's meant people coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan that are basically crippled by the effects of what they've been through, oftentimes not being able to leave their house, you know, panic symptoms, just to try and go and buy milk at the grocery store, extremely high rates of suicide in that population, and all the sort of conventional mental health therapies that might be applied and consistent with the research in that area are not very effective for the most part, or trying to dull those symptoms. No prospect of kind of curative intent and having people at high rates get back to you know, their historical way of functioning before experiencing that trauma. Mm-hmm. The MAPS phase 3 trial, they've had an early look at the data. So first of all 6 phase 2 trials showed the same thing, and the mm-hmm. and the phase 3 trial, because of COVID-19, the US FDA said, can we see how much information can be gleaned from the trials now that they've had to be halted because of COVID, and they've shown a 90% chance of effectiveness without having to enroll any additional participants because of COVID. And they're showing cure rates of about 70%, where people no longer meet the symptom criteria for PTSD. So this is, wow.
And that's utilizing MDMA.
That's using MDMA. Now, yeah. I should just be really clear for your viewers. We're not talking about, here's a pill, you know, you're on your own. Right. We should define the process, which is similar regardless of the substance, which is really about intention setting around your goals and the changes you're hoping to make. And so in the case of post-traumatic stress disorder, that would be looking to reconcile your traumatic experience and envisioning a future for yourself where you can move past that trauma. That would be a sort of typical intention, and there may be other sort of lifestyle things wrapped into that.
So does that mean in the treatment that there is also going to be a human interaction that's saying, so this isn't just unfolding in your brain, you're exactly. having this conversation with somebody else, and you're helping to, you know, guide your thinking to the place that you want it to be.
Exactly. So people like trained psychotherapists, psychologists, and other trained mental health professionals would be setting you up for the experience in that preparatory work, then really doing a deep dive through the experience when you're on the medication. And through that, and through the neuroimaging and all the other basic science work that's been done, people with trauma can actually be held in a space while they're on that medication where they can reconcile that trauma and move through it in a way that they're not consumed with fear and emotion that actually even talking about it, you know, makes things worse. And then when you come out the other end of that experience in the coming days to weeks, there's integration work to continue to integrate the experience and how you want to live your life now that you've visited that place and you're looking to move on. So that's the main indication for MDMA, though there's a host of other indications where there's a lot of excitement.
So it's my understanding that also if you're in that treatment phase, if subjected to an fMRI, that when being observed, you can actually see a physiological change in the brain.
There's parts of our brain, and we've come to learn this sort of neuroplasticity of the brain, and that the brain is an organ like others that, you know, you can flex and build muscle and you can create pathways. And if you're in a constant state of fear with PTSD, that sort of fight or flight center becomes hyperactive and isolated from other parts of your brain, and you can actually get areas of your brain talking that don't normally talk and develop new neurological pathways and ways of dealing with stress that help you move past, you know, water runs down a hill through the path of least resistance and will form a trench there, and it becomes difficult to get out of that.
Right.
And metaphorically, that's what these substances can do in the case of post-traumatic stress disorder. The other substance is psilocybin, which is the active molecule in magic mushrooms. The molecule itself is almost indistinguishable from LSD. It has a sort of proton attached to the side, so very similar. Mm-hmm. That doesn't create the same sense of openness and sense of safety for people that that MDMA does. It creates more of a sort of loss of ego, where people go to a place that they might not otherwise go, where they have a sense of sort of losing the disconnect between themselves and others and the environment. And the neuroimaging work really shows how the sort of ancient brain that can be implicated in addiction, that has us do kind of the reptilian compulsive brain and our more evolved thoughtful brain, in diseases like addiction don't tend to talk very well. And psilocybin helps with connections there. And psilocybin has been used. There's phase 3 trials ongoing now for depression that are extremely promising. And work that's been done with addiction, alcohol and tobacco addiction, which is extremely compelling. So two quite different molecules and therapeutic processes. There's people looking at other substances as well. But psilocybin and MDMA are probably the big two on the forefront of research and clinical care right now.
So I think it's probably important to point out this is not a response to the opioid crisis. It's more that we have mental health challenges in the country that are costing us dearly.
If you look at addiction, the throughput or underlying in a lot of addiction is mental health. And so if we can address the actual underlying cause of what causes a lot of addiction, then you know there's a bigger piece at play there that really we want to be at the forefront of trying to support. Yeah.
Well, it is like the cost is enormous, isn't it? And it's a combination of things. It's lost to individuals. It's lost to families, communities, provinces, countries, even globally. Like I was looking at the numbers that are on your website, and they are staggering. Yeah. So was there anything in your own background that sort of led you to say, this is something that I want to get onto?
You know, I founded Numinus really from a personal standpoint. I had struggled with my own both chronic physical health issues and mental health issues my whole life. And from a late teens, early 20s, really was taking a hard look at that and trying to rectify what was going on for me. And even though I was extremely dedicated to my mental health and working with therapists and doing sort of all of your easily accessible, you know, Western modalities of dealing with those different things that I was struggling with, got myself to a point a couple of years ago where I was out of options. I was being hospitalized once a week and had tried just about everything that I could do and ended up turning to psychedelic therapy personally to try and save my own life and did so and came out of there and really, you know, opened my eyes to what would be possible and how I could support what was going on.
So, Evan, when we talk about PTSD, that is one component of this. But does this treatment not have similar effects on addiction, let's say for tobacco or for other substances that are really, really difficult to kick?
Yeah.
And so then how does it work from a neurological perspective to be able to make the shift, especially when somebody is going, I've tried, and I can't do it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, first to your point about the opioid crisis, because I think, you know, one thing to put on the table is that these drugs have been traditionally illegal and now they're coming forward in a research context. But it really flags that there's been many victims of the war on drugs and society at large the biggest. Because it's meant that, you know, with things like the opioid crisis that are really because of the war on drugs, and then in the case of potentially beneficial molecules not being researched for their benefit. So we're not managing the public health issues in the way we should. And I'm of the view that we should be regulating drugs for public safety to prevent all the organized crime and gang violence, but also to improve the health of communities and deploy law enforcement resources where they could actually have a benefit instead of driving the market to ever more toxic kind of ways of being.
Right, because of the miniaturization of the whole chemical process.
The fentanyl crisis is a natural consequence of prohibition. So putting all of that aside, and I think, you know, when you raise the issue of the opioid crisis, there's so many things that we should be doing that we're not, that's a whole other conversation. And psychedelics have not been studied in opioid addiction, though.
Right.
That research, I believe, is coming. They have been studied in tobacco and alcohol addiction. Mm-hmm. And something that I see as an addiction medicine physician, probably the most common thing I see is somebody who's really motivated to make the change. Mm-hmm. They've come to rock bottom. That's why they're there to see me. Mm-hmm. And they want to make a change, and their sort of thoughtful brain is saying, you got to stop. You know, it's affecting your relationships, your work, your employment, whatever it may be, they're there for help. But that craving and that bad decision-making brain, that reptilian brain that I was alluding to, can totally overpower the best intentions. And in Alcoholics Anonymous, for people that have been helped through the 12 steps, there's often a conversation around a spiritual awakening. Huh. Where something happens, and it is an epidemiological phenomena. If you look at even the most severely addicted people, most will go into what we call long-term abstinent remission or recovery, but we don't have tools to bring that about. Mm-hmm. And so you often have the situations where people are, you know, having horrible outcomes in their lives and cost to society in terms of healthcare costs and just something that we really should be treating much, much differently. And we don't have tools to bring about that spiritual awakening. But the psychedelics has been shown at Johns Hopkins University for tobacco, at New York University with alcohol addiction, that there's a way of bringing about what in AA they call spiritual awakening, where people can reconcile that sort of underlying motivation to use that they haven't been able to get control of with a thoughtful brain that has come to the place of understanding that they need to stop. And the cure rates that they're seeing, and I say cure, which is different from a symptom management model, but if you look in the case of the nicotine work, these are people that have lung disease, you know, emphysema from smoking, or they've had a heart attack directly because of their pack-a-day smoking habit. Physicians have been telling them, look, you're going to die if you don't stop, and they can't. And then they get enrolled compassionately into these psilocybin studies, and you can measure contine, which is the nicotine metabolite in people's urine, and these people are not smoking. They're not 12 months out from this therapeutic psilocybin experience. And
somebody could be watching this and saying, okay, Evan, what actually happens to my brain that it seems to grow this addiction to whatever it is that I'm held hostage to, and how come I can't just on my own reverse that pattern?
People describe these experiences, and Payton would be best to do that now, but in the surveys when you ask people, they describe it as, you know, among the most important experiences of their lives, even though they're coming into a research clinic But you ask them a year later, you know, tell me about that. Well, I'm still carrying that. That was one of the most incredible things. And when you measure personality traits, which are really people's personalities, there are people, for instance, with PTSD who can't hear a horn or a book drop without, you know, always being vigilant. And those are personality characteristics around fear that people carry with them, and they're normal traits too. Mm-hmm. But people go through this type of therapeutic experience with an acceptance of their own life and of the universe, and no longer carry those negative personality traits related to fear or anger or resentment. So these are incredibly powerful molecules. So mm-hmm. when you say, you know, why can't we just, well, I'd love it if we could just have people log onto their computers and do a, you know, watch a video or do something like that. But these are molecules that can fundamentally change people that they look back on those experiences as something extremely profound that affected their worldview. So it's not something simple, and the changes are positive. They're pro-social changes where people feel more connected to their community, more empathy, less fear.
So for people who have watched at this point, they're going to be going, okay, how long before I can have access to this kind of treatment?
It's a tough question. You know, you as Evan said, you know, breakthrough therapy status for both MDMA and psilocybin in the U.S. points to, you know, there's a real effort to get these things moving and out to the public. So it's hard to put an exact time on it, but I think you could see something sooner than later.
Yeah, there's companies that are coming into the space to make these medications that will be completing phase 3 trials and applying to Health Canada to be able to supply them. Mm-hmm. And I think that's, you know, impending, you know, 18-month time horizon, like soon. Mm-hmm. In the U.S., there's three countries that are involved in the MDMA trials, the phase 3 trials: Israel, the U.S., and Canada. Mm-hmm. And the federal government in Israel and in the U.S. have approved compassionate access. That's outside of clinical trial mm-hmm. access. Okay. And there's active conversations around compassionate access in Canada that would come probably prior to the approvals. So this is, I think, just the path is there with the research being completed, approvals being sought, and organizations that are looking to create safe places where people can access these therapies. I certainly think in the next couple of years, this will be headed towards access for people in the community.
Thank you for coming in and sharing this. I feel like I want to talk to you for another hour and a half because I'm fascinated by the whole process, but I wish you the best of good fortune in your research and moving forward.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks so much.